Good morning. I hope everybody is doing great this morning. Happy hump day. Don't have anything else for you except you can be half asleep today and follow along with today's lesson. This is a reprieve after yesterday. Yesterday was an exercise in scriptures and understanding and English and everything else. Today should just like flow smoothly, not any other scriptures to go to besides what we're gonna read. All right, Heavenly Father, we come to you thanking you and praising you for yet another day that we've never seen before, Lord God. But we thank you, Lord God, that you go before us. Father, it's been said, Lord God, not to be afraid to trust an unknown future to a known God, Lord God. And so glad that we know you, Father. We thank you and we praise you, Lord God. So glad that you gave us your word, Lord God, so that we can study your character, Lord God, and your attributes, Father, and to know how, Lord God, to approach you, even in times of prayer, Father, coming to you humbly, Lord God, but yet boldly before your throne, Father, because of our advocate, because of our Savior, because of our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who died on the cross and whose blood was shed for us, Lord God, and covers our sins, Father. We just thank you and praise you for this day, Lord God. I ask that you would be with us as we go throughout it, Father. Help us to represent you, Lord God, indeed, Father, and if necessary, Lord God, represent you in word, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, it's going to again be simple on today. We're going Acts chapter 7, and we're going to start with 17. Just to get us started, we'll read through 22, go back and start talking, but hopefully we get into the 30s today. So let's go ahead and start. Acts chapter 7, verse 17. But when the time of the promise drew nigh, which God had sworn to Abraham, the people grew and multiplied in Egypt, till another king arose, which knew not Joseph. The same dealt subtly with our kindred, and evil entreated our fathers, so that they cast out their young children to the end they might not live. In which time Moses was born, and was exceeding fair, and nourished up in his father's house 3 months. And when he was cast out, Pharaoh's daughter took him up, and nourished him for her own son. And Moses was learned in all the wisdom of the Egyptians, and was mighty in words and in deeds. And when he was full 40 years, oh, I said 22. All right, we're gonna stop at 22 real quick. All right, let's go ahead. Verse 17. But when the time of the promise drew nigh, what promise are we talking about? We're talking about, remember that God promised Abraham that he would have seeds as many as the grains of sand, where he couldn't even count it, and the stars of the sky. And he also told them, you know, that they would come into a promised land, but before that, remember that they would be enslaved for 400 years. And so it's that time that is drawing nigh, right? That promise. And the people grew and multiplied in Egypt. And when we're talking about grow in this sense, we're talking about physically. Okay, so they're getting older, and then multiplying is there are more of them. And right now I'm going through Leviticus in my own, no, just finished Leviticus. I'm going through Numbers in my own study. And it was numbered 603,550 men that were 20 years old and above that were able to go to war, not including the Levites from the 12 tribes that left Egypt and went into the promised land. And so you can see that they are multiplying from that 75 that initially came there to this, all right? And whenever your promise is getting close, you know, things start to prosper, you can best believe that Satan is not just going to let it happen, all right? Verse 18, till another king arose, which knew not Joseph. All right, don't forget that that Pharaoh is a title, okay? Title, king, but it's not a name. So there came somebody along, and you can't tell me that he hadn't heard about Joseph. He just didn't care about Joseph, okay? There is no way that your entire people, your entire nation can be sustained and can survive because of somebody and you not know about them. I'm sure he knew, hey, these people over here in Goshen, it's a lot of them where they come from. So I'm sure he knew the backstory, but he just didn't care. Verse 19, the same dealt subtly with our kindred and evil entreated our fathers so that they cast out their young children to the end they might not live. All right, the subtly means crafty. So this Pharaoh, this king, he wasn't all out like Herod in Jesus's day where he was like, look, anybody that is three and under, that's a male, kill him, right? He wasn't like that. What he did was he would go and tell the midwives, hey, when you're delivering these Hebrew children, if it's a male, kill it, okay? And the midwives were actually afraid of God. And so some of them didn't do that, right? So this is what's going on. So they would cast out the male children because, of course, male and female, it takes to reproduce. And the problem was there were too many of them and he wanted them to decrease. So if you don't have any males, then that's what's going to happen, right? And so verse 20, in which time Moses was born and was exceeding fair and nourished up in his father's house 3 months. All right, Moses, I love the way that is actually pronounced Moises. And I don't know why, but I love the way that that sounds. So Moises was born and that means drawing out. And he got his name because his mom had put him at 3 months, put him in a basket with pitch, almost like an ark, okay? So did that and then put him in the bushes and he was floating and Pharaoh's daughter happened to be down there with her handmaidens, more than likely taking a bath. And his sister, actually Miriam, was on the side watching to see what was going to happen with her brother. And Pharaoh's daughter discovers him. And I'm sure it made a difference. Okay. I don't know if y'all want to call me carnal or not, but I'm sure it made a difference that the baby was exceeding fair. All right. And in this term, fair means handsome. If the baby wasn't cute, I don't know that Pharaoh's daughter would have went ahead and kept the baby, right? And so what she did is she realized, hey, this is a Hebrew baby. And so Miriam was like, you want me to go find somebody to nurture it for you? And she was like, yeah. So Miriam actually went and got her mother. And Pharaoh's daughter pays Miriam's mother. I think her name is Zipporah, actually. No, not Zipporah. Anyway, pays Moses's mother to actually nourish her own child, you know? And so that's what God will do for you. He will give you perks and benefits to do what you ought to be doing anyway, and the enemy don't even know it. So this is what's happening in verse 20. So for 3 months, she was able to hide him. And after that, she went ahead and put him in this water. In verse 21, and when he was cast out, Pharaoh's daughter took him up and nourished him for her own son. All right. So after he was weaned off of his mom, then he went back to Pharaoh's daughter. Verse 22, and Moses was learned in all the wisdom of the Egyptians and was mighty in words and deed. This is so important for when he becomes the deliverer because he knows the ins and outs of the kingdom. He was there. He was raised in it. He can speak their lingo. He knows exactly what is going on. Okay. And so he's growing up. And he's being raised as an Egyptian, even though he realizes he is a Hebrew. 23, and when he was full 40 years old, it came into his heart to visit his brethren, the children of Israel. All right, this number 40 occurs often in the Bible. You know, Jesus was in the wilderness for 40 days. Moses was on Mount Sinai talking to God for 40 days. They were traveling in the wilderness for 40 years. And so they've taken the number 40 to mean like a transition period, a transformation period, sometimes a time of testing and trial and all of that. And so Moses is now 40 years old. He's been raised all his life as an Egyptian. And God placed it on his heart to visit his brethren, the children of Israel, right? So be mindful of the things that God places in your heart. And so he does that. And in verse 24, and seeing one of them suffer wrong, he defended him and avenged him that was oppressed and smote the Egyptian. All right. So he sees an Egyptian and a Hebrew striving together. And so he's like, you know what? This ain't going to happen to my people. And so he kills the Egyptian. 25. For he supposed his brethren would have understood how that God by his hand would deliver them, but they understood not. All right, so God has placed this in Moses' heart that he's going to be a deliverer of the Hebrews, right? So he knows this and he believes that it's supposed to be in the manner that he's doing right now. You know, he's killing Egyptians, knocking them off, you know, whatever it takes for them to not be oppressed and for them to be delivered. But it's just like any place else. The Hebrews are like, okay, you're not my deliverer. All right. Don't come in here thinking that you are high and mighty and that, you know, we're supposed to respect you. You don't even understand us, you know? So it is amazing how people don't even see your similarity because they're looking at your differences, all right? Moses was a Hebrew. He was born a Hebrew, not raised a Hebrew, but the Hebrews were like, psh, you've been up there in that castle. You don't understand how it is down in the hood. You don't understand what it's like in the streets having to survive. Don't come up here with that mess, all right? And so verse 26, and the next day he showed himself unto them as they strove and would have set them at one again, saying, sirs, ye are brethren. Why do ye wrong one to another? But he that did his neighbor wrong thrust him away, saying, who made thee a ruler and a judge over us? Will thou kill me as thou didst the Egyptian yesterday? So if you go back and you read in Exodus or Genesis, you will find out that Moses didn't think anybody saw him when he killed the Egyptian, except the one that was striving with the Egyptian. But word got out that he actually killed an Egyptian. That's not good. But Pharaoh, when Pharaoh hears it, all right? And so now that this is made known unto Moses, that somebody else has gone and told what happened, we read verse 29. Then fled Moses at this saying, and was a stranger in the land of Midian, where he begot two sons. All right, so because of that is the reason that Moses is fleeing. Let's go back up for a minute. And so this next day after he kills the Egyptians, two Hebrews are fighting. And Moses is like, yo, why are you doing this? You know, and I say this all the time, you know, we want people to know that Black lives matter, but Black lives have to make sure that we matter to each other. Okay, we can't be out here pimping each other and killing each other and, you know, doing all of this stuff to each other and then tell another race that we matter. We have to make sure that together we are united, all right? And also in this, sometimes you can miss your deliverance and end up in bondage longer than you really need to be because you reject the deliverer. If the deliverer doesn't look like you, then you ain't trying to hear it. Now, don't get me wrong. If you are trying to be delivered from promiscuity, you don't want somebody who has been a nun all their life or somebody who got married at the age of 16 and has been married for 50 years to tell you how to quit being promiscuous, okay? You want somebody who was promiscuous, like I talked several weeks ago about this lady I knew who had a baby and then for like the next 23 years, and I'm sure she's probably that way now unless she's married, but she was celibate. You want somebody like that to tell you how to not be promiscuous, but at the same time, don't reject the deliverer that God has sent to you, okay? And that's what they're doing because Moses don't look like them. Moses doesn't look like them, right? And so That is where we are going to end today. I want to make sure that there's nothing else. Actually, the land of Madian is the land of Midian as well. All right. This is where Moses is going to meet his daddy-in-law, Jethro. And he ends up having two sons. And I think that is where I want to end today since the time went off. I told y'all can be half asleep today and follow along. Unlike yesterday, it was like, okay, this roller coaster, when is it going to end? Because this girl. All right, let's go ahead and close out with prayer. I love y'all so much. Heavenly Father, just thank you and praise you for who you are, Lord God. Thank you again for the backstory, Lord God. Thank you for letting us know, Father, where Christianity was born from, Lord God, and the trials and tribulations that they went through, Father, which helps us, Lord God, as we go through them. If we can find our situation in the Bible, Lord God, it is so much easier, Lord God, to endure because we know, Father, that you change not, Lord God, and you're a deliverer, Lord God. You're a healer, Lord God. You are a way maker. We ask, Father, in the name of Jesus, that you would be with us as we go throughout this day, Lord God. Again, Father, help us to represent you just in what we do, Father. Help us, Lord God, to preach the gospel without saying a word, Father. Help people to notice that something is different, Lord God. And when they come to us asking what it is, Father, help us not to be afraid, Lord God, to claim that it is you, Lord God. Help us, Father, to remember that you said if we deny you on earth, that you'll deny us in heaven. Or Jesus said that, so that he would deny us in heaven in front of you, Father. We just thank you and we praise you, Father, for who you are. It is in Jesus' name that we do pray. We give you thanks in advance, Father. Amen. Y'all have an amazing day. I will talk to y'all later. Bye-bye.